five factors or five aspects of the Buddha vision are mentioned in the first sermon of the Buddha called Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta. They are named by the Buddha as Cakkung, literally meaning insight, Jnanam, meaning knowing, literally. Knowing is visible only in relation, in comparison with the past experience. Therefore, Cakkung is cognition, Jnanam is recognition in relation to the past memories, in comparison with the past experiences. Thereafter, Panya, literally meaning wisdom, it really the acceptance of the reality as it is. Then comes Vijja, literally meaning realization of the Four Noble Truths. Finally, Aloko, meaning enlightenment. Aloko is light, but here it means enlightenment. The special feature of this enlightenment, because enlightenment ultimately consists of these five factors. They are mentioned consecutively one after the other in the Dhammacakkappavattana Sutra, but they got awakened in the Buddha instantaneously, one at the same time. Akaliko is a timeless phenomenon. Enlightenment is timeless. It is for the explanation Buddha has used these five words to explain five aspects or factors of enlightenment. The final factor is enlightenment itself. It means after enlightenment, there is knowing but not knowledge. There is sensation not based on knowledge. A direct sight, it is an inner sight. In Patisamvada Magga, it is explained, Buddha vision, is boundless, timeless. He can see any past event as it is here and now, any future event as it is here and now. There is only the present moment, without the past or the future separate from the present moment. The past itself is in the present, and the future itself is in the present moment. But this is not the chronological time. In the chronological time, in the material time, there is past, which you remember, and there is the present moment we experience at the moment, and there is the future that we expect, or that we dream of. But here, Akalika means the psychological time, free from past and the future, here and now. It can be seen here means Ehipasika. It can be seen now means Sandhittika, as used in Pali by the Buddha himself to express what is meant by the Dhamma or the real Dhamma called Nirvana. The past and present is not in the Buddha vision. Here means the past and present, the psychological past, psychological future. In our case, we remember things, we have memory cells, and we consider the memory as the truth. But memories are only illusions. They are only mental images that are present at the present moment. And with the past experience, we project our mind into the future. That's a dream. The future is not yet born. The past is dead and gone. The reality is here and now. That is what the Buddha sees. Here and now, as a timeless phenomenon, Buddha saw, that is cognition, sight. This cognition is insight into the present moment. And recognizing the present moment with respect to the future, with respect to the past mainly, not to the future, but with respect to the past. We see somebody and we recognize that person as a father, mother, brother, sister, daughter, son, friend, enemy, etc. That recognition takes place in relation to our past memories. After recognition of the reality, what the Buddha really saw, he said, at the enlightenment he experienced some phenomenon that he has never heard of before. Buddha's own words in the Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta are Pubbesu Annusutesu Chakkumudapadi. I saw, there arose an insight into a phenomenon that I have never heard of, that was never heard of before. Then when that aspect, never heard of before, comes in, it turns into recognition of what he experienced at that moment of enlightenment. Recognition with regard to the past. It can be compared to anything in the past. It was not heard in the past. Therefore, it is entirely a new, fresh experience with a novelty, with a freshness. After that realization, through recognition, he realized what he had been experienced so far was dynamic, in a state of transformation, and nothing can retain a permanent identity. That is the nature of everything that we experience mentally or through our senses. Whatever we experience is subjected to birth, decay and death, because every item in this universe is made of universal energy. Universal energy is not a static thing. It is always dynamic. It is creative. It is always changing in a state of transformation, transformation of energy. Here transformation means one state changes into a different state. That is why it was said by Heraclitus, that lived in the 5th century BC in Greece, that philosopher said, no one can step into the same river twice. Because once we step once, second time, we cannot step into the same river, because what we stepped into at the first instance has gone down the river. The river is always new for us to experience. Therefore, the Nirvana, the Buddha experience, is always new. It is not on the past, not on the future, but here and now, according to his vision. Then one we realize that everything in this world is born to decay and die. That is the realization that the first disciple of the Buddha, Anna, Reverend Annakondanya, the ascetic, got after listening to the Buddha's first sermon. Buddha said, they are developed or they are awakened in Annakondanya, the insight they refer to as the Dhamma Chakku, the ability, the capacity, the inner eye to see the Dhamma, to see the Nirvana and the nature of the world. The nature of the nature. By the nature of the nature in which we are, which has created us, whatever that is created is subject to decay and death or destruction. Generation lead to degeneration and ultimate extinction. When this truth is realized, what happens to the wise man? This then crops up the wisdom. It is the wisdom which we find at the basis of the supreme bliss called Nirvana. It is a bliss. The mind is blissful when it is not attached to anything, when it is not resentient to anything, when it is not ignorant of anything, when he is vigilantly sensitive to his experience, but not resenting the experience, nor getting attached to the experience, one can experience a blissful state of mind. That is akin to, that is similar to Nirvana, temporary Nirvana. We call it temporary, the mind is tranquil, peaceful, calm, quiet for a moment. But it can get disturbed again if you are not enlightened. In the enlightened, nothing can disturb the peace of mind, the tranquility, the peace, the bliss in their mind. That is what is said in the Mahamangala Sutta, Puttasya Loka Dhamme Chittangasana Kampati. The enlightened mind never gets disturbed or perturbed by any worldly vicissitude, any worldly changes. Not excited by the good, not depressed by the bad. Whether the good happens, whether the pleasant happens or the unpleasant happens, enlightenment can take things as they are. But in our case, in ordinary case, we like the pleasant and we dislike the unpleasant. But the enlightened mind is free of that because that mind has realized that there's no point in getting attached to anything because everything is impermanent, changing, transforming itself. Nothing can retain a permanent identity, that is called anatta. The transformation is called dukkha. The creativity of everything, the dynamism of everything is called dukkha, according to Buddha Sutta. Once that is realized, and that realization is called panya, wisdom, and Buddhist meditation called vidarsana bhavanava is named as panya bhavanava because the basis of that meditation is wisdom, seeing how things are changing without getting attached to anything, without getting resentful to anything. This is what is expressed by the Buddha in the Dhammapada Maggavagga. Sabbe sankhara anicca, sabbe sankhara dukkha, sabbe dhamma anatta. Sankhara means formations. All formations are anicca, dynamic. Sabbe dhamma dukkha. All formations get transformed. All formations lead to transformation, change. Sabbe dhamma anatta. All phenomena, whether mental or physical, all phenomena are unable to retain a permanent identity. That's called anattata. A permanent identity that we think of things and beings is only an illusion. Nobody is permanent, no thing is permanent in this universe. In realizing this, there arises the ability to realize the Four Noble Truths. When you look at the transformation called Dukkha, here the Dukkha we normally recognize as the Dukkha in our mind. Because Buddha saw everything in his own mind. Mind is all thoughts are transforming, getting changed, changing from moment to moment. Every thought is born to decay and die. No thought can remain forever. Then the cause of the transformation of the mind, the thought, Buddha said as tanha, the desire, the root of desire. Tanha, Buddha referred to the word tanha in Pali comes from the Sanskrit word trishna. The literal meaning of the word trishna is thirst. But here in tanha it refers not to our normal thirst for water, for liquid, but the mental thirst for pleasure and happiness. And mental thirst for pleasure or happiness is called kama tanha. And different people like the pleasure in different forms. Some may like sweet food. Some may like hot food. Some may like cool food. Some may like heated food. Different people have different taste. Therefore, the thirst for what one is desiring, what is desirable to oneself is called bhava tanha. He wants food or anything to be in a particular way, in a particular manner. Bhava means to happen. It should happen in this way. Now for example, we like some fruit. We don't want unripe fruit. We don't want sour fruit. We want root to be ripened. We want the food to be sweet. We don't want the food to be ripened beyond the limit. That means we want something means bhava tanha. We want it to happen that way. Vibhava tanha means we don't want it to happen in another way. That means we have likes and dislikes. It is because our likes and dislikes there arises thinking. Cause of thinking is the presence of the thirst for pleasure, the thirst for pleasure in a particular manner, the thirst for pleasure not in any other way, different from what one desires. What happened at the enlightenment, his vision is, there is no thinking, visankara gatan titta, as Buddha uttered in the first pian of joy. He was experiencing a thoughtless mind. Why there were no thoughts? There is no necessity to think of anything. We think of things that we like, dislike, or that we are ignorant of, but we are unable to understand. What we like means we think of things because of raga, attachment to what we like. We think of things because of our detachment or resentment to things called dosa. Therefore, the main cause for thinking is attachment and resentment, raga dosa, as well as the ignorance of what the real bliss is. We think, we believe that we can be happy if we get what we really desire. But that desire can't last long. What we desire as babies in our childhood, we don't desire at the moment. What we desire in our young days, girls desire the company of boys, boys desire the company of girls. And that also fades away. When you get older and older, you like to be alone, leaving to yourself. You don't have the same attachment to girls or boys that you had earlier. Attachment and resentment also are subject to decay and death. That is why they are called formations. They are only sankhara. Sabbe sankhara anicca, all formations are dynamic, always creative, always changing. Therefore, sabbe sankhara dukkha, in a state of transformation, changing from one state to another state. Therefore, sabbe dhamma, all phenomena are unable to retain a permanent identity because there is a constant transformation. This is the basic reality one experiences at the enlightenment. With that experience, it is wrong to say experience. To experience, there must be somebody who experiences. Buddha said chakku madhapadi. Buddha did not say I saw. There arose an insight, a vision. It's a boundless vision. A Buddha vision is boundless, means not bound by time, not bound by space, no distance in space, no distance in time. But that is not a vision the Buddha can maintain every moment. Only when he wants something to be known, he gets into the trance of the Buddha vision. Normally, things he always questions Reverend Ananda. What is that sound? What is that? How is that? He doesn't want to get into a samadhi or trance and find out things. Because for that he had to exert energy, and using that energy, when it is possible to know what he wants to know through Reverend Ananda, it is futile to use that energy. It is called pāna atipāta. If we use our energy, mental and physical energy, while we can know it without using such amount of energy, physical, it is foolish. Buddha is wise. Therefore, Buddha vision called sabbajñatta. Sabbajñatta means omniscience. He can see anything beyond time and distance. That we can't experience. Buddha visayo achintyo in Achintya Sutta. We can't experience it because we don't have that vision. We can have only an idea of that vision. Idea is an illusion and imagination, but as these ideas were expressed by the Buddha himself and by his enlightened disciples, we cannot deny them though we do not know them. Therefore, Buddha vision, although we describe, we speak in terms of knowledge, in terms of past experience, in terms of what I have heard of, in terms of what I have read, although I am not enlightened, although I am not a Buddha. But it is advisable not to deny what the enlightened disciples of the Buddha and what the enlightened, supreme enlightened being called Buddha has expressed. Although they are only words, and although they carry only ideas, but to realize the final truth, first one should have the Sutta Jnana. Sutta means the knowledge that we gather through listening. That was the way at the time of the Buddha, the olden days. Now we can read, and now we can use our computers. We can use the internet, we can use the television, we can use the radio. There are so many sources of communication, imparting knowledge to us. Knowledge is useful to us in the material sense, but not in the spiritual sense. No amount of knowledge about Buddhism can enlighten you. You may read the Buddha's canon called Tripitaka several times, but you will not get enlightened. Not even Margapala. Because those books in the canon contain words, sentences, and stanzas. And the commentaries made by the disciples, Buddha's enlightened disciples, learned disciples, carry their idea, their interpretations of those words and sentences. But they are useful, because Sutta Jnana can lead to Chinta Jnana. You can start thinking independently. But by thinking, you are not enlightened, but one who has heard the Buddha's word is called Sutta Buddha. A well-heard person, well-read person on Buddha's teaching is called Sutta Buddha. Then one who has thought a great deal about Buddha's teaching is called Chinta Buddha, thinking Buddha, hearing Buddha and thinking Buddha. Then there's a practicing Buddha through meditation. Buddha Buddha means one who has got really enlightened. Not Bhavanamaya Buddha, but the Buddha Buddha means one who realizes the truth within oneself. How do you realize the truth? Not through reading the Buddha's teaching, not through reading or listening to the commentaries, to the interpretation of those teachings, but seeing within yourself. Seeing within yourself for enlightenment can be called Buddha vision. You too can have a Buddha vision, enlightened vision, but that may be not limited. Gautama Buddha had an unlimited Buddha vision, but you can have a limited vision. You can realize what is blissful, what is tranquil, what is peaceful in your mind. We can get inspiration from what we have heard and read about Buddha's teaching. Those experiences can be made our own experiences through thinking and through practicing. Practicing as said, or seeing within our own mind. We said Buddha vision is free from raga, dosa, moha. Raga is attachment, dosa is resentment, moha is unawareness. But when you are aware of something, if you have no attachment to it, if you have no desire for it, if you have no resentment or hatred towards it, you are having a state of peaceful mind. When somebody is scolding you, blaming you, insulting you, if you can just be aware of it, that aware, very awareness, without any attachment or resentment, without an attachment to your own good name, personality, selfishness, self-image, without beginning attached to your self-image. You just listen. You are not listening, you are hearing. But here is a difference between listening and hearing. We may see, but it is different from looking. Insight comes in inner looking. You see, you go deep into it. Going deep into it is called prajna. It's called prajna bhavana. You see means your knowledge shows that this is this. The knowledge interprets. But you can go beyond the knowledge, there comes the wisdom, you can see things for yourself. Therefore, we too can realize through our inner sight whether what the Buddha has spoken is right or wrong. When mind is free from greed, hatred and illusion, it is a peaceful mind and it is called a kusala chitta, alobha, adosa, amoha chitta, free from ill will, free from desire or greed or attachment. That's the mental state that you yourself can experience. That is for inner bliss. And such a state of mind is resting without thinking. A restful mind, a mind that is resting. The mind is not using its mental energy, not using its physical energy for thinking. Conservation of energy is there, reservation of energy is there. And that mind is very energetic because it is not misusing energy. And when you read for some time in that trance of non-thinking, you can rejuvenate your mental and physical energy. And that resting is very useful in our day-to-day material life. We can gather more energy to do more work to make our material life successful. And such a meditation can be practiced every moment, in any place, anywhere, at any time. That means living with an enlightened, with a Buddha vision. But the enlightened vision, I should not get attached to anything. What is the point to get attached to it? I can enjoy without getting attachment. If you can enjoy without attachment, if you can just be there without any resentment, your mind is at peace, and that itself is a bliss. There is no harm in enjoying life. That is why Buddha said, Sachitta Pariyodhapanam, before that he said, Kusala Supasanta. What is Kusala? Alobha, Adosa, Amoha, state of mind. In Dhammapada it is said, Idanandati, Pechanandati, Kata Punya Ubayata Nanjati. Kusala is, Punya means a pleasant mind, a peaceful mind, mind free from hatred, greed and ignorance, being aware of things as they are, Yathabhuta Jnana Darsana. That is called a Kusala Chitta, and that Kusala Chitta is called an enjoyable, delightful Chitta. It brings in delight, inner delight. It's called Ananda. What is wrong, according to Buddhism, is getting attachment to much delight. Your mind may be delight at what moment, but it can be momentary. It can't last long. Even if the delight vanishes, there's no being in resenting the absence of delight or happiness, coming in of unhappiness, because unhappiness too can turn into happiness. Therefore, Buddha vision, the basis of Buddha vision, you can have a Dhamma Chakku at any moment, have an insight. With that insight, you can have a discriminating knowledge of what is right and what is wrong. Then, with that insight, with that discriminating knowledge, you can take the side of what is right and what is correct. That is Panya, wisdom. Insight leads to knowledge, knowledge leads to wisdom. Wisdom leads to realization. The entire nature of the nature. Nature is anicca, dukkha, anatta. Nature is always changing, transforming. The cause of transformation is there. It is the nature of our mind that means, not the physical nature outside. The nature of mind is always based on tanha, the desire to be active. Mind is activated by the desire, the thirst for pleasure. When there is no thirst for pleasure, the mind is deactivated. The mind is there, sensation is there, without a desire for pleasure and without resentment for displeasure. And there is a peaceful mind. The realization dukkha, you can realize the cause of dukkha, suffering. And you can realize also when you know the cause in there itself. Cause means if you know it is because of our desire, it is because of our mind liking, it is because of my thirst for pleasure and suffering. The suffering in itself becomes, you become wiser. Then you know the dukkha, dukkha samudaya, dukkha nirodha. Then you can realize the way to end the dukkha nirodha. Arya attangiko margo. What is the Arya attangiko margo? Right vision, sammaditti. Right sank. Right thought, samma sankappa. Right word, samma vacha. Right action, samma kammanta. Those are things that you can practice at any moment, anywhere. Therefore, Buddha vision in you, Buddha vision means enlightened vision. Enlightenment means wise vision. What is wise vision? A vision that can make you blissful. By understanding what causes the bliss, what causes the pain, what causes pleasure and what causes pain. Those things have to be realized by self, not by following anybody's teaching, but following your own experience. You can be enlightened at your level. You may not be fully enlightened like the Gautama Buddha, but you can have a mini enlightenment to be blissful in your own small world. Therefore, the basis of Buddha vision are the five aspects of enlightenment. Five facets of enlightenment that I have spoken of. Chakkum, Jnana, Panya, Vidya, Aloko. That means you can bring light to yourself. Aloko means light, enlightened. And his last advice to his disciples who were not enlightened was, be a light unto yourself. And we have been discussing how to be a light unto ourselves. We can be light unto ourselves by seeing the truth, the reality, the real nature of the world, the real nature of things, the real nature of the nature. That is the right vision that we can have to lead the life of bliss. even in this material world. And if you were to live a life of bliss in the material world, that very bliss can enlarge into unlimited bliss at the final enlightenment.